Hey guys, it's Nick. Welcome to another episode of T-365. Today's episode, we're covering the updates from Microsoft in November of 2023, including all the Ignite updates from this past month as well. As always, this content's built for the MSP space, so we block out the noise from the 100 or so announcements that come from Microsoft each month. As a quick reminder, I do supplement this with a blog post down below that you can see to have more information about all these announcements, including helpful links, video tutorials, things like that. Getting into it though, we're going to start off with Microsoft Teams as we usually do. These first announcements are related to Copilot and Teams that came out of Ignite as well. You can see down below in this screenshot, this is a user going in and using Copilot to craft a response within the Teams channel and is able to adjust based off the tone that they want to use as well. There was many more announcements related to Copilot and Teams, but I've linked that below in the actual blog post as well. The main thing to keep in mind here is that Copilot licenses are open in GA for a limited subset of users today, and they're not available within CSP yet. The ETAs on that are more towards the April timeframe of next year, but there are a lot of cool features coming out continuously for Copilot. Voice isolation is the other one here that came out. This does not require a premium license. I think it's really cool because I've always felt that Teams is really good about noise cancellation, noise suppression, but this is taking it even a step further to recognize your voice and block out everything else within the call. So it should make the calls much more clean in the future as well. This will happen mid-January, be complete by mid-February. This one is actually Teams premium feature, generative background effects. It's using AI to basically portray a new background that enhances your existing background as well. Interested to see how that actually works, but again, does require that premium license. This will come out early 2024. Shared calling is the next one here. If you're using Teams voice and Teams phone system within your environment, this is giving you the ability to enable groups of users to make and receive calls using a shared phone number and calling plan. So just kind of separating that out from the previous functionality. This is GA today. You can go into the portal and set this up as a policy as you're seeing down below. Click to call was another cool feature here where you can support this click to call on your own website. This could be used for sales and support activity that you want to have with your customers. Obviously, this would require a little bit of custom dev work, but you could outsource that to look at streamlining certain experiences with your customers that may be a little bit more personable. Timelines for this is early 2024. Private line was another one related to the phone system here. This is giving users a private second phone number so that they can be reached directly without having to go through any type of call queue, and they'll bypass delegates, admins, or assistants in this feature as well. This is another one that'll happen early 2024. This is just an update as far as the naming convention goes, but file app in Teams is being updated to OneDrive app, as it should be, because that's exactly what you're seeing when you go in there. And it's being updated with a new UI around OneDrive as well. This will happen late November, be complete by mid-December. Next one here is Teams chat embedded in Outlook on the web. So previously, if you're in Outlook on the web, you click into Teams, it navigates you to a different browser window. Now you'll have an integrated experience where you don't have to leave Outlook. They're currently rolling this out and it's going out in waves, so should become fully available within the next few months here. The other one is related to simpler and quicker creation of Teams and channels. So we're seeing a lot of proliferation of Teams themselves within the ecosystem, at least Microsoft is. I definitely see it across customers, things of that nature. So what they're doing here is giving you a quicker experience to create the team or channel, but giving the option to just create a channel instead, to hopefully reduce the proliferation of actual teams and create more channels instead, because there's a lot better ratio that you could have there and consolidate the information as well too from a data security perspective. So this will happen early December, be complete by mid-December. Last one here for Microsoft Teams is the official announcement of the automatic update into new Teams. So all of us have been prompted today from Microsoft to try out the new Teams when we enter, if we're still using the classic experience. And this is going to be the hard cutover date. So if you haven't cut over, you'll be automatically cut over after March 31st. So that April 1st date is when that'll happen. So you want to get ahead of this with your end customers or end users as well. Shifting into EntreID here, this first one's pretty important announcement also to pay attention to because it does or will impact your users potentially. This is Microsoft hard enforcing conditional access policies for multi-factor authentication in your tenant. So it's kind of expanding off of our previous security defaults mentality of having MFA turned on by default. And this is creating these three policies that you see down below in this screenshot within the tenant. And it's going to be in report only mode to start, but then after 90 days, they're going to flip those to on. And obviously you have to have the licensing in order to support these policies as well in the sense of the enablement, but it will start to enforce multi-factor for users that have not previously had that. So I've seen it in my tenants that I use for testing, but you can go check in your tenants as well too. This is very important because again, it'll start to hard enforce multi-factor authentication. You want to get ahead of that from the communications that you have. This will happen between November and late December. The other one related to security here is Microsoft being able to support device-bound passkeys in EntreID. So this is using the actual physical device key or device-bound passkey, if you will, for mobile and desktop devices as a secondary authentication phishing-resistant method that they're adding. They're also going to be changing some of the UI nomenclature around this for people using things like FIDO2 keys and Hello for Business. You can see that more so in the screenshot down below, but it is a little bit different of a prompt. So again, if you have users that are using FIDO2 keys, may just want to give them a heads up that this is going to be changing so they don't come to you with questions about, is this the right one to click now or something of that nature. It should be pretty intuitive because it still says security key here, but it is something that you might want to just message. This will happen in January of 2024. The other one here related to security is the suppression of the Microsoft Authenticator prompt on mobile devices when the sign-in is considered risky. So this is something that they've seen a lot of telemetry around, and they've actually blocked like over 6,000 prompts in the sense of them coming over as a risky sign-in. And the user, the only caveat here is the user can still click into the Authenticator app and go in and approve the request. But it should reduce some of the more malicious attempts or false attempts that we've seen over the past. This all stemmed from MFA fatigue, things of that nature. Obviously, you can also mitigate this through conditional access policies, but this is GA today. So if a user is getting their notification suppressed, it's likely it's a risky sign-in. Shifting into Microsoft Intune here, another one related to Copilot. This is the security Copilot. Talked about this last month as far as the early access program, but I wanted to bring this up for Intune because I think this is so cool in the sense of the pain point. If you've administered Intune and dealt with the Intune Admin Center, there's some of these things that are really powerful. In this screenshot, you can see the policies and you're asking it, you know, to summarize it. And it's basically giving you the security impact, the end user impact, conflicting policies within the tenant. It's super informative based off all the information. Another screenshot I have on my blog shows this with asking you to create a policy based off of specific requirements. So it's kind of pulling together all those settings to recommend the policy that you should create, which is really cool. And again, if you've administered this, you know there's hundreds of settings in there. So it's hard to nail them down sometimes, especially as Microsoft has moved things around in the UI so much over the years. This will happen in late December in the private preview for those early access customers. No sense of GA timelines at this point in time. The other announcements that came from Ignite here were some additions to the Intune app suite. This first one is Enterprise App Management, and basically it's a catalog of applications that they're presenting you with for ease of use when you talk about deployment, but also from that software update perspective. And so you can see in the screenshot, they're giving you the ability to have visibility into the third-party patching statistics, if you will, for these applications. The caveats being that, you know, it is a limited subset of catalog items, may not encompass the applications that you have, and it's part of the Intune Suite add-on, so it's not part of your base plan. Can also be purchased standalone for $2 a user a month, which is pretty steep when you talk about just that as its own solution. But this will be in February of 2024, as far as when that's releasing, and then March for government customers. Similar vein here, Advanced Analytics is coming out as part of the Intune Suite add-on. It's also available, going to be available for $5 per user per month, which is really steep when you think about that. But effectively here, I've talked about this before, it gives you a lot of analytics, advanced analytics about device performance and more proactive data around those devices. But in this iteration, you're also getting access into device logs where you can run queries against your devices depending on certain parameters that you enter, as well as what you see here in the screenshot, which is more of the performance-based statistics as well too, such as the startup performance, battery health, the application reliability, app crashes, blue screens, those types of things as well will all be available within the analytical report here as well. So it'll be interesting to see how this evolves over time, but I kind of in agreement with everybody in the sense that it's a pretty steep cost for something that you would feel like would be baked into the core service. Last one here for Microsoft Intune is related to macOS. I've made a lot of content on macOS and Intune in the past, but Microsoft's continually making more investments into this over time. And into the next year, they have a laundry list of things that they're doing. Definitely check out the blog that I link below for more information about all the settings. Too much to list on one slide, but I've highlighted some of the ones I'm most excited about, which is being able to use Entra ID passwords to log into Macs. That's a huge win, something we've been waiting for forever. Automated local account creation through the Intune Admin Center. Awesome feature, definitely something that is a pain point today. Remote help for macOS, so being able to remote into macOS devices. Being able to deploy and package applications that go out to the apps or to the devices, in addition to the existing patch management capabilities there are. More to inform on with this announcement, but those are just some of the really cool ones I saw there. So definitely check that out if you're managing Macs today. Shifting into Microsoft Outlook here, these are both related to Stream within Outlook. So this first one I thought was cool just because it's giving you the ability to record a video of yourself, your screen, or both directly within Outlook and just insert it directly into your email. It reminds me a lot of Loom, if you have any or familiarity with that particular app or tool. But this is cool to me from the sense of support. If you could train your end users to record their screens using that, and they're already using email to submit their requests to you, if you train them to record in that manner, it creates a seamless experience and you get more of the information you need to troubleshoot the issue as far as the help desk goes. So this will happen December, be complete by March, along with this next announcement here, which is related to being able to watch the stream recordings inline with an Outlook versus needing to pivot into the browser to view those videos. So same timeline here, but both pretty cool announcements coming to Outlook. This one for SharePoint, I think has been a long time coming, honestly, but Microsoft's finally introducing a electronic signature service tied into SharePoint. It's going to be a pay-as-you-go service where you're charged per request that you make, but I think it's going to be a great alternative for somebody like myself who doesn't necessarily need an Adobe subscription because I have e-signature requests very infrequently or need them from other people infrequently, but enough that it maybe warrants a subscription. So pay-as-you-go is a pretty good model for that. I'll be interested to see how this looks. There's more information in my blog. This will be coming out late November, be complete in Q1 of this next year for the US, and then into 2024 for the other countries as well. Shifting into the last section here, this is the admin section. The first one's related to the public preview of Microsoft 365 Backup and Microsoft 365 Archiving Solutions. These were both announced at Inspire, not Ignite, but now they've gone into their preview section. You can actually go spin up a subscription. They are both under a consumption model, so you pay per gigabyte of things that you're backing up or archiving. So with the backup product, you can see here, you can back up SharePoint, Exchange, OneDrive. With the archiving product, you can archive a dormant or legacy SharePoint sites as well to free up some of the storage that you have there. A lot to unpack, probably do another video specifically just on this, comparing it to existing backup solutions. But I thought it was an interesting announcement, definitely something you could try out. Microsoft Loop generally available. This is the Notion Evernote-like application I've talked about in the past, but I think it is going to replace OneNote eventually just because it's Copilot enabled, it's native integration or has native integration with the other suite offerings such as Teams and Outlook, things like that. And it is included with your base licensing. Most people have one of these plans, right? I think in most cases. So this is something I would definitely check out as far as a note-taking tool, collaboration tool that goes outside of a Word document, things of that nature. It's a little bit easier to use with the shortcuts that you have for bulleted lists, headings, those types of things. I'll probably do a video on that specifically as well. Next one here is just a name change announcement, but I think it's going to cause some confusion. They're naming or renaming Bing Chat Enterprise to Copilot. So it's just Microsoft Copilot, not to be confused with Microsoft 365 Copilot, which is going to be highly confusing, I think, for a lot of people, but it is going to be generally available December 1st. It's another licensing model that comes part of your existing licensing, such as Business Premium E3.5. And it does not require this waiting period what we have for Microsoft 365 Copilot. So just note, if you see this in your browser for Bing or chat or renamed to Microsoft 365 or Microsoft Copilot, you don't actually have Microsoft 365 Copilot licensing. So that's already going to be a handful of confusion and frustration, I think. Last one here, multi-tenancy coming for Defender XDR. Huge announcement, I think, just from a security sense. This is Microsoft kind of tearing into the pain points that MSPs have today, I think, around managing multi-tenancy and not being able to adopt more of Microsoft's Defender offerings because of the lack of multi-tenancy. This is very beta today, I will say. You can add tenants up to 50. At this point in time, I think it's going to take Microsoft a while before this is a pretty good solution for MSPs, in my mind. But I think it's a good first step, just to see that they're trying to support this and more of that model of multi-tenancy for security. So that's everything I have for you guys today. Definitely like and subscribe if you want to see more content like this month over month. And comment below if you have any questions about anything that I discussed. Until next time, guys, have a great day.